Welcome to Hammonton today. I'm Ricky Chandleoni alongside Emily Costello. On today's show, we will see students and staff discuss topics like underage drinking, texting and driving, sports, and more.
But let's get right to our first story, relationships. Whether it's a celebrity relationship or your own, there are always some rough times. For more on that, let's go to Stephen Andrews Gavage.
Until wedding, we all thought would last a lifetime. Sadly, only lasted 72 days. Chris and Kim got separated on October 31st. Unfortunately, it was because Chris told Kim she needed to lose weight. Class News is here at Hammonton High School to find out how students and faculty would ask their significant other they need to lose weight.
I wouldn't even tell them. I would just break up with them.
Well, first of all, I don't think weight matters in a relationship. So if my significant other needed to or did not need to lose weight, it really shouldn't make a difference. We can decide together if we want to be physically fit and be more in shape, then we can do that together and decide as a partnership that we both want to feel better about ourselves. But if my significant other doesn't feel that he needs to lose weight, then that's up to him.
I really wouldn't, but I would start cooking very healthy things, not keeping any junk or salty stuff that he likes in the house. And maybe I would ask him, let's go for a walk. Don't you think we should jog? Something like that. So he wouldn't even know. It would be sneaky.
We like baby, need to lay off the Big Macs.
My husband, Frank, absolutely loves food. Loves it. But I would simply tell him that I love him so much, I care about his health and well-being, so he'd have to lose weight. And I would help him do that.
The reaction varies, but we found that most people would secretly tell their significant other they need to lose weight. I am Steve Anderskevich, and back to you.
Looks like there are varying opinions on telling your loved one they needed to lose weight. What's next, Emily?
Wow, Ricky, underage drinking is a serious controversy in this nation. For more opinions on underage drinking, let's go to Aaron Ortiz.
Thanks, Anchorman. We all know that the summer's coming up, and we all know that students unfortunately like to drink. So we're here at Hammonton High School asking students what they think about underage drinking. Students like to take advantage of an unsupervised home by taking alcohol from their parents or from their older siblings. Alcohol is already dangerous to people over 21, with people getting into crashes in cars or people just doing stupid things.
What are your positions on underage drinking?
I think there are a lot of better things to do than drinking. I think kids are too young, and it's bad enough that 21-year-olds sometimes don't even know how to handle it, and a student definitely can't handle it. I think that there's a lot of alternatives to drinking, like you can play sports and things like that, you know, hang out with your friends and have sleepovers, stuff like that. Go to the beach.
Underage drinking is bad, so we could just read a book or go play a game of video games.
My views on underage drinking are it's okay in moderation, but people shouldn't binge drink. Instead of drinking, I hunt and fish and go in the woods and hang out with my friends and stay away from things that will get us in trouble.
We're looking forward to an alcohol-free summer. I'm Aaron Ortiz at Hammonton High School. Back to you.
Thanks, Aaron. Looks like most people can find alternatives to underage drinking.
Along with underage drinking, gay marriage is a serious topic that is debated. For more on that, let's go to Annie Maldonado.
Gay marriage has been a controversial topic for many years all around the nation. Some people agree with it, some people disagree, and some other people just doesn't care. Let's see what students at Hammonton High School has to say. Governor Chris Christie put a veto for gay marriage, but he said it should be up to the voters in the state of New Jersey and to make them vote upon it.
I think there's much wrong with it. I mean, it doesn't really affect me in any way, so why should I bother? I mean, people love each other, so what?
Absolutely. I feel as though that everyone has the right to marry whoever they want to marry and spend the rest of their life with whoever, whether that be male or male, female or female, or heterosexual.
I think gay marriage should be legal because it's not really up to the government who you fall in love with. If two men or two women fall in love with each other, then I think it's up to them if they want to get married or not. And that's it.
Students at Hammonton High School seem to agree that gay marriage should be legal and it shouldn't be such a problem. This is Annie Maldonado, back to the studio.
Thanks, Annie. It appears that most people think they can do whatever they want. What's next, Emily?
It seems texting and driving is a serious problem throughout the nation. No matter how many laws are made, people still continue to do it. For more on that, let's go to Dylan Mahoney.
As cell phones and other portable devices have become more prevalent in today's society, a new issue has emerged and is steadily on the rise: texting while driving. Texting while driving, time and again, has shown to be quite dangerous. Studies have shown that this act may be, in fact, even worse than driving while inebriated. It is also assumed that teenagers and young adults are often guilty of this. What is their point of view on the subject?
Michael Fleming, what is your opinion on texting and driving?
I think it's wrong.
How wrong?
Like, real wrong.
And what are you going to do in a situation where you could text and drive?
If I could text and drive?
Will you do it?
I don't know. I'm not trying to die. That is pretty risky.
Are you going to text and drive or no?
Sure.
What's your opinion on texting while driving?
It's stupid.
You text and drive and don't lie.
No.
You're a liar.
No.
I've seen you.
No, you haven't.
You text and drive.
No, I don't.
What are you going to do if you see your friend texting and driving?
In the car with me?
Yeah.
Take the phone.
You don't let your friends text and drive?
No.
Why?
Because I don't want to die.
Now, Helen, what is your opinion on texting and driving?
Horrible. Shouldn't do it.
Would you ever do it?
No, I can't. I need glasses.
You've never texted while driven?
Never.
Do you know any friends that text and drive?
Yes.
And what do you tell them?
Don't do it. I'm not driving when you put your phone away. That's it.
What's your opinion on texting while driving?
I think texting and driving is bad because it distracts you from the
road. You do it?
No, bitch, just crashed my truck.
You're a liar. You text and drive.
Oh, yeah, sometimes.
And you think it's as bad as people make it out to be?
No. It's not as bad as people make it out to be.
Have you ever gotten pulled over for texting and driving?
No.
Here's a few of the many diverse opinions offered on the subject. And while they are varied, one thing is clear. Students do recognize the danger between texting while driving. Back to you in the studio.
With the NBA playoffs in high gear, talk of who is the best player always seems to come up. For more info on that debate, let's go to Russ Fortune.
Hello, viewers. My name is Russell Fortune here with Hammonton High School News. It's two names that come to mind when you think of the NBA: Kobe Bryant and LeBron James. Today I will be hosting interviews on your opinions on who's the better player. Who's better, Kobe or LeBron?
Kobe, definitely. He's a more versatile player. He got a good outside game, good inside game. Been in the league right out of high school. I mean, what else to say? He's got 5 championships. He's got multiple MVPs. Got multiple All-Star appearances. I mean, he's just a man. And once he gets that 6th ring, he's going to be on top. Plain and simple. LeBron who?
Here with former Temple alumni basketball player, Mr. Josie. Who's better, Kobe or LeBron?
I'm going to say LeBron because you look at Kobe right now, he's by himself. He won his championships with Shaquille O'Neal, and he had a supporting cast and Derek Fisher and all those people. So LeBron didn't have anybody until recently, you know, with Dwayne Wade. I think you'll see LeBron win a couple of championships. I think he's an all-around better player than Kobe. I think Kobe's a little selfish, where LeBron's a little bit unselfish. I think people are comparing Kobe at his best, and I don't think we've seen LeBron at his best yet. So I'm going to go with, hands down, LB.
Another person who knows something about the game, we have basketball coach Mr. Martino.
Well, when we talk about Kobe and LeBron, I'll break it down as simple as this. Kobe's clutch, LeBron's not.
Kobe or LeBron? I'm going to have to say LeBron on that one. Because Kobe, man, he's a ball hog. He always got to take that mask off his face. He doesn't dish the ball at all. That's why he's been averaging like 30 points a game. But then you got, in LeBron's case, he'll always like to dish the ball and get those assists. Even though he's still averaging 27 points a game, he always like to dish the assists. He's not a one-man show anymore like he used to be in Cleveland. And even though LeBron don't got as many rings as Kobe, he'll be getting there soon with the new roster he got with the Heat.
I want to be the best.
be the best. Simple as plain. That's why I play the game. To be the best, you have to win. And that's what drives me.
He's the best player in the game. It's just that simple. There's nothing that Kobe Bryant can't do. He will defend your best player. He will shoot from the perimeter. He will get all in your mug. He will do whatever it takes. He is the most complete basketball player in the game today, bar none. He has an assassin's mentality. I said this when the trade went down, and I'll repeat it again. Who's starving more for an NBA World Championship more than Kobe Bryant? There is no one. This guy is highly motivated.
What separates Kobe from the pack?
More than Kobe Bryant. There is no one.
Kobe doing work. Two for on my shirt.
Who's the best leader in the NBA today? Hands down, it's LeBron James. A great leader possesses different qualities: competence, composure, great communication skills, and strong character. He possesses all of those. LeBron James is a great leader.
LeBron James has all the tools, but his strength is actually twofold: physical and also mental. He can get to the lane at will, get up in the air and absorb contact with that great physique. But let's get to the mental part. LeBron James came into the NBA at 18 years old. He's absorbed all the expectations and all the stardom. He has not read his press clippings at all.
There has never been a player in the history of the NBA that has the size and strength of LeBron James, yet has the straight-ahead speed that he has in the open court. It really separates him from any other big, small forward that's ever played this game.
At 6'8", 270, here's a guy that can handle the ball with the best of them, has unreal athleticism, passing skills, can play four positions, an improved jump shot, a high basketball IQ, very unselfish, and also the ability to make other guys around him better. LeBron James, the complete basketball specimen.
With today's interviews proved that one thing, that on the topic of LeBron and Kobe, is still up in the air. Russ Fortune here with Hammonton High School News. Back to you, studios.
Go ahead. I guess there's no winner on this. Well, that's all we have today. I'm Ricky Chang Leone.
And I'm Emily Costello. Thanks for watching Hammonton Today. Have a great day, everyone.